As we leave Cootamundra, the wheeze which can be heard is a leaking joint on the middle cylinder cover.
Engineer of the Flying Scotsman, Roland Kennington.
My main concern at this stage is the centre valve, which has a lubrication problem and may possibly seize up.
The dry country of southern New South Wales, we head off to Sydney, 266 miles away.
soon as I knew he was coming, I booked me seat. No worry, wouldn't miss the Flying Scotsman or anything.
As we travel through the wide brown expanse of the Australian countryside, I'm struck by the vivid contrast with the lush green fields of England.
Dozens and dozens of woodcutters, and the wood used to be stacked up in the railway yards, and when they were loading the locomotive engines in the engine shed, they'd come out with a little old yard engine and the trucks and take the wood into the loco sheds and light the big engines up with it in the fireboxes.
At Goulburn, the great southern railway junction of New South Wales, a group of volunteers enthusiastically prepare the locomotive for its grand entry to Moss Vale.
We're going to service the engine, oil it, clean it, prepare it for the next part of the journey.
Alright, just giving it a general clean down and to rub some road grime off it. It's been run from Melbourne now. It's probably it gets pretty grimy after, you know, about 400 or 500 miles, and down in Melbourne we've been giving it a clean every once a week. And
this
makes it look better. It's just a bit of shine among the grime, and it brings up the finish 100%.
How do you think the engine's running?
Oh, magnificently. We'll buy one.
Just put a mic on for that camera.
Oh, yeah, right.
The Queen Mother travelled on the train. It was quite an occasion. It was the first time a preserved steam loco has ever worked a royal train, certainly in Great Britain, and I was chosen for the job. The job that I'm normally given is to look after the buffers and coupling. You probably saw me polishing the buffers back home, amongst other things, amongst oiling and looking after it. I usually give them the job of looking after those. They usually say, don't touch Tony's buffers. They used to be beautifully quartered with emery paper, so they look like four separate segments, but it's a hard job to do it out here, because we every time we go in the depot, we have our luggage, a tool van, on next to them, and it's the buffers on that scuff them and spoil them. So I find it easier to just polish them with a bit of emery. Even that coupling, when it was in Britain, it used to shine like chrome. I took that home and did it in my back garden with an electric drill for about a week, polishing it to get it like that. But it was my pride and joy.
Thank you.
first saw this train in 1927 when I started work at King's Cross in a goods station there. And I used to pass through King's Cross station every morning at 10 o'clock when this was leaving for Scotland. Used to do 392 miles in 8.5 hours in those days, and it gradually speeded up.
As you can see, there's a lot of dirty work involved with it, but it's very nice. The biggest problem is washing up after you've done everything. Bringing it out here, of course, was the next problem that we had, beside all this. We had trouble with the getting it offloaded in Melbourne, so it had to come to Sydney. And Sydney went to run it to Melbourne quickly for the bicentennial. Well, prior to arrival at Moss Vale, we're going to take the electric lights off and refit the original oil lamps. In Britain, they ran with oil lamps all the time. They never ran electric lighting. We had to fit electric lights here for safety reasons. But we'll exchange these so it is absolutely authentic as we come into Sydney with the original oil lamps. Just of interest, when it ran in America, it ran with a large headlamp up the top, a cow catcher and an automatic coupling fitted to the front, which we haven't had to do out here. So the engine is, other than the electric light, basically as you see it running in England, there's been no alteration. Thank you.
are some of the last conventional rolling stock, soon to disappear from New South Wales rails. Meanwhile, at Moss Vale, preparations are underway for the historic meeting between three great locomotives. The Scotsman will meet the legendary 3801, built in New South Wales in 1943, the leader of the 38 class, and the American loco 5910, designed and built by Baldwin Lima Hamilton.
To Australia. The Scotsman, of course, and all the steam, which is beautiful, lovely, and just the whole atmosphere, so, and the noise, yes, is beautiful. Nothing nicer than a steam train.
Well, the Flying Scotsman to me is really great to have in Australia. I've been a collector of trains since I was about 10 years of age, and I've got the Flying Scotsman in my collection, and to actually see the real thing, I never thought I'd ever do it because I'd have to go to England to do it, to think somebody brought it to Australia. It's absolutely great.
I served in the Green Howard Regiment and spent 6 months doing escort work through the north of England, escorting prisoners from mostly from Darlington and Newcastle and down to London and backwards and forwards, and travelled quite consistently on the Flying Scotsman. That would have been 45, 46 and 47.
Yeah, in 1928 I went on that train to Edinburgh, and I never forget the beautiful journey that it was in that. So I went and gave it a good pat, like a pat of good. So we're quite happy about it. I would swoosh through the station, right through as if, you know, 100 miles an hour. It was beautiful to watch it just coming through. To us little children at that time, it was a miracle.
And they all had green engines, always painted green. But they, you see, before they amalgamated and called them British Railways, it was a little boy's, fantasy land it was. Well, during the war, just hooked onto a train of about 60 vans, and we'd had the warning, they're over the coast. I said to my mate, I wonder who's going to get it tonight. We knew, shower of incendiary bombs, straight on us. I said, right, I hooked the train up. I said, why? I said, hook it off quick. Well, we hooked it off and went in the cutting, and all the heavy stuff come down then. We were pinned down for 12 hours in Coventry, burnt all the train out, just like one great big lake of fire. That was at Watford. Had about 6 hours wait at Watford until we could get a clear room, because they were blowing the bridges out, 10 a penny, you know. But it never took them blokes long to put them back in. They'd put a new bridge and viaduct in 12 hours. And we'd be on it again. Yes, it's been a good life. I mean, you are the man. The driver is responsible. You've got to take all responsibility. None of this stopping on the side of the road to get water. I've been running with about 300 gallons of water in the tank, and hoping and praying as I can pick about 2,500 gallons up on the troughs. And as soon as I hit the troughs, I can pick 2,500 gallons up in about a minute, fill the tank. Well, again, I'll tell you one night, I got a freight train this night. I said to my mate, I said, we'll pick water up on the troughs. I said, okay, see, the old fashioned dip, it worked on a vacuum system. Pushed it across, down it went, pulled the rod out, and then put her in centre for being off. Well, we shoved the trough down, and you know what we got? We got a full tank and a case of oranges. Come down the back of the tank, the freight train in front must have slipped off the back of it into the trough, and we picked them up. And the oranges rolling down the coal onto the footplate. That was a laugh.
Thanks for coming over to me, old mate.
Right.
Terrific.
It's a pleasure. It's a pleasure.
Lovely.
It's a
come up from yourself.
This famous engine, built in 1933, and the first engine to exceed 100 mile an hour. We are indeed fortunate it's here today, and that we can see and enjoy this magnificent machine. On behalf of the volunteers of 3801, I have a banner here which we will attach to the Flying Scotsman, which it will carry during its stay in New South Wales.
I can't imagine all these people turning up to see a diesel come through. But the most important thing is it gives us a chance to be together, and that's absolutely priceless. Especially the other week, last week, wasn't it, when it did a kilometre and 31 seconds. And I would think that would be about 117 k's. And, you really know you're moving then.
The 38 I'd rather have, because it's synonymous to New South Wales, synonymous because the elite of the steam engines were built for the passenger flag carrying service of New South Wales system.
Magnificent logo. I travelled all the way to Perth this year in April, and then back to Adelaide, and then from Adelaide back to Sydney on it. The Flying Scotsman, I've travelled this one from Melbourne today. The last time I recall on this train was in 1958 Easter time, travelling to Edinburgh, which was a great trip, of course. It was cold, snow, and an overnight trip. That it was a brilliant trip.
I'm a member of the Great Western Society, although I've never been to UK. And the Flying Scotsman represents all that's great about British steam. It's sleek, it's the beautiful lady of steam, streamlined, powerful, quiet in its operation compared to locomotives from other places in the world.
South Wales thoroughbred, the 3801, approaches Strathfield.
Thank you.
this stage, Roland, we've travelled some 590 miles. How do you feel?
Relieved and elated at the same time. The Scotsman has performed magnificently in spite of the concerns regarding the middle valve.
The media have billed this event as a race. The fact is, as rail enthusiasts know, it's to be a parallel run. And excitement is building as two thoroughbreds of steam meet for this historic event.
It's a dead heat. I won't say it. Dead heat. They're both beautiful.